Buongiorno, anzi, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Today, English pyjama lesson about Popper's theory of science. Good morning, Miss Sandra. Good morning. You are the first of your class. Very, very good. Fine. Now we have Dario. Good morning, Mr. Dario, and good morning, Miss Margherita. Today, English pyjama lesson about Popper's theory of science. Ma mettiamo ugualmente un po' di musica. Mozart, sonata di Mozart. Allora, dopo i primi tre, Beatrice, buongiorno Beatrice, ciao Roberta, siete rapidissimi oggi. Ciao Margherita. Ciao Francesca, Sara, Gabriele, Chiara, Gaia, Giorgia, Arianna. Today, English pyjama lesson about Karl Popper's theory of science. Philosophy of science. Today, philosophy of science. Ma ascoltiamo. Let's listen to this beautiful music. It's Mozart. Enjoy this music, this gorgeous music. Ok, buongiorno, non mi ricordo più dove ero arrivato, Edoardo, buongiorno Edoardo. Ciao Nunzia, grazie del tuo apprezzamento. Ciao Chiara, ciao Silvia, ciao Daniele. Buongiorno. Welcome to this English pyjama lesson about Karl Popper's theory of science. Karl Popper theory of science. But now enjoy this music. Mozart, it's Mozart. Un'altra sonata di Mozart. I don't know the English word for sonata. Gaia, no, Gaia. Silvia, do you know it? The English translation of sonata. I am sonato, but that is sonata, another thing. Buongiorno, non mi ricordo se ero arrivato a Silvia, a Daniele, comunque adesso dobbiamo interrompere, sono le 10:29, battutona, oggi vi propongo una vera battutona perché è una battuta di Albert Einstein, quindi attenzione, no? Che Dice, tutto è relativo. Prenda un ultracentenario, risponde a un'intervista, è una battuta che Einstein fece nel corso di un'intervista, e quindi l'intervistatrice gli chiese qualcosa e lui rispose scherzosamente, tutto è relativo. Prenda ad esempio un ultracentenario che rompe uno specchio. Sarà ben lieto di sapere che ancora ha 7 anni di disgrazie. Grande, grande, grandiosa battuta. Bene, Iari, è arrivato anche Iari, quindi we can begin this English pyjama lesson about Karl Popper's theory of science. So, who is Karl Popper? Karl Popper was born in Vienna in 1902. His parents were Jewish, but converted to Lutheranism. And so he had a Lutheran baptism. After having followed many and different kinds of studies, he graduated in 1924 and became teacher of elementary school. And in 1928, earned a doctorate in psychology. Then, in 1934, fearing the Nazis, Anschluss, do you know Anschluss, of Austria, Popper wrote his first work, his first great work, The Logic of Scientific Discovery, no, the logic of scientific discovery, no, in 1934, with which he meant to get some academic position in a country that was safe for Jewish people. Finally, in 1937, he got a position as a lecturer in philosophy at a university in New Zealand, where he lived until 1946, when he moved to England to teach logic and scientific method before at the London School of Economics and then at the University of London. In this way, he got the British citizenship. The British citizenship. He became a citizen of the United Kingdom. In 1959, he published a new edition of his first main work, a new edition of The Logic of Scientific Discovery. Then, in 1963, he published a new work, Conjectures and Refutations. Conjectures and Refutations. in Italian words, congetture e confutazioni, congetture, conjectures and refutations, confutazioni, congetture e confutazioni. Popper died in England in 1994, at the age of 92 years. So, a long life, a philosopher of a long time philosopher. Now we can speak about Popper's theory of science. Any questions about his life? No. Good. Popper claims that human knowledge arises from the crash between one of our expectations and an experience that clashes with it, and an experience that clashes with it, and so contradicts it. For example, we expect that the bell rings now no more, but once, no. Do you remember when we were in our class, in our school, and when we were waiting for bells ring, for the ring of the bell? Do you remember? So let's remember that beautiful situation, our old scholastic life. We haven't now anymore. So we are waiting for the bell, the ring of the bell, and at the end of the lesson, but the bell doesn't ring. Otherwise, we are in the middle of our lesson. We aren't expecting any sound, but suddenly the bell rings. In both these cases, we ask ourselves, why? Why does the bell ring? And so we get, in this way, we get a problem, and we try to solve it, to answer our question. Why does the bell ring? Now, why doesn't the bell ring now? According to Popper, knowledge derives from this try to solve our problem, from our try to answer that question, a question of that kind. Okay. You got it? Clear? I hope so. in more philosophical terms. A scientific discovery is always an attempt that can succeed but fail as well to resolve a problem born from the scientific research. I repeat, in more philosophical terms, a scientific discovery is always an attempt that can succeed or fail as well to solve a problem born from the scientific search or research. So, according to Popper, science is generated by problems, and a scientist is, first of all, a man who is able to point out problems and, to say so, to worry about things. The true scientist is, first of all, a man who is able to point out problems and, to say so, to worry about things. But, of course, science means trying to solve problems, those problems as well. Then, how can you solve those problems, the scientific problems? Popper replies, holding that we have in our minds an innate knowledge. We have in our minds an innate knowledge. Every man has in his mind an innate knowledge, and so we can and have to use it in which way? How? Our innate knowledge consists of, firstly, our genetic heritage, i.e., that is our mental predispositions. Now every man has some mental predisposition innate in him, and aptitudes due to the evolution of human species. So, our innate knowledge consists of, one, our genetic heritage, i.e., that is, mental predisposition and aptitudes due to the evolution of human species. Two, our cultural heritage, composed by religious, artistic, philosophical, literary, scientific ideas. Our cultural heritage. So, on one hand, our genetic heritage. On the other hand, our cultural heritage. From our innate knowledge, we can draw two resources, two resources, for the scientific research. These two resources are: one, some selective standards to orient our observations, and so to gain significant cognitive experiences. I repeat, from our innate knowledge, we can draw two resources for the scientific research. One, some selective standards to orient our observation, and so to gain significant cognitive experiences. Two, the matter from which we can find our inspiration in order to elaborate conjectures to get the solution of scientific problems. Two, the second kind of things we can draw from our innate knowledge. The matter from which we can find out inspiration in order to elaborate conjectures, hypotheses, to get the solutions of scientific problems. So, using these resources, scientists can produce a scientific theory. That is, what is a scientific theory according to Popper? A scientific theory is a set of universal statements about nature. Popper's definition of scientific theory. A scientific theory is a set of universal statements about nature. Very, very simply. In Popper's view, scientific theories are only a development of our innate aptitudes to stress similarities and to pinpoint the regularities of our experiences. I repeat this. In Popper's view, scientific theories are only a development of our innate aptitudes to stress similarities and to pinpoint the regularities of our experiences. So, but Popper argues that there is a decisive difference between a scientific theory and every other kind of theory. Now, pay attention to this difference, to this distinction. According to Popper, there is a fundamental distinction between a scientific theory and other theories of different type, of different kind, which is it is the possibility to criticize and refute a theory on the basis of experience. More specifically, by means of an experimental test. So, the specific quality of scientific theories is the possibility to criticize it and refute it on the basis of an experience, namely by means of an experimental test, by means of an experiment. So, clear? Do you have some question? Write if it's necessary, write your question about all that I am exposing. I am saying you. So for this motive, Popper calls the scientific procedure inverted commas, trial and error method. Popper calls the scientific method between inverted commas trial and error method, meaning in this way that the experimental control can also reject a theoretical hypothesis. Trial and error method. It means that the experimental control of a theory can also reject a theoretical hypothesis, a theoretical conjecture. So, but what does the trial and error method consist of? How is it possible to compare the universal with the singular? Because a theory is universal, but an experiment is singular. So there is a great difference. In other words, since a theory is universal and instead an experiment is singular, which is the way to get an experimental control of a scientific theory? A question of method. Popper replies that the scientific research is a process based on three steps. The scientific research is a process based on three steps. The first step, scientists must use freely all their creativity based on their innate knowledge to devise a new theory, to invent a new theory. The first step. Scientists must use freely at all, their creativity based on their innate knowledge to devise, to invent a new theory. The second step. Scientists have to deduct almost one singular consequence, namely a prediction, a singular prediction from the theory invented. The second step of scientific process is deducting almost one singular consequence, namely a singular prediction from the theory invented at the first, the former step. So, the third step. Scientists can and have to compare the singular prediction deducted by the theory with a singular experimental result. Better, as Popper exactly sets, with a between inverted commas, with a basic statement that is the logical and linguistic translation of a singular experimental fact. I repeat this third step of scientific process. So, scientists have to compare the singular prediction deducted by their new theory with a singular experimental result. That is, according to Popper, a basic statement. A singular experimental result must be translated in a basic statement. A basic statement is the copy of an experimental result. So, in other words, a basic statement is the logical and linguistic translation of a singular experimental fact. Basic statement. So, an example. According to Popper, the most emblematic example of the trial and error method, of this trial and error method, of this process, of this scientific process, is Einstein's theory of relativity. Relativity. Why? Because, one, Einstein, according to Popper, elaborated his theory of relativity only by means of his thought, only by means of his thought, of his mind, of his mental creativity, i.e. on the basis of his free mental reasoning, without any antecedent experimental confirmation or support. Einstein elaborated his theory of relativity only by means of his thought, i.e. on the basis of his free mental reasoning, without any antecedent experimental confirmation or support. 2. Einstein himself pointed out some consequences of his theory, as the prediction of the deflection of stars' rays passing near the sun due to the gravitational field of the sun. Einstein pointed out some consequences of his theory, some singular consequences of his theory, like the prediction of the deflection of stars' rays passing near the sun due to the gravitational field of the sun. Three. In this way, the English scientist Eddington, do you remember? The English scientist Eddington could manage the famous experiment which attested the basic statement between inverted commas, a stellar ray passing near the sun is bent. A stellar ray passing near the sun is bent. This basic statement matched with the prediction of the theory of relativity, and therefore Einstein's theory was confirmed by Eddington's experiment. Okay, now we can do a pause of relaxing as usual, another Gianna Nannini song. Vediamo questa. Sentiamo com'è. Ok. Up. Yes. No.
Caldo non c'è, dormendo me. viaggio inutile di solitudine.
Oh, wow, avanti. Ecco. Up, down, up, down, up, down, breathing, up, down, breathing. Okay, now this. Round our life in the double sense of life.
Nemmeno arrendermi tra le braccia.
Up our legs up. Bene, well, we can return to speak about, to talk about Popper now. Some question about what I told to you till now. Nothing. All clear. Answer. How useful Popper's falsification theory would be to expose this fake pandemia. It's another kind of... Okay, yes, thank you, Beatrice. So, attention. We have seen that according to Popper, Einstein's theory of relativity was confirmed by Eddington's experiment. But Popper states this corroboration doesn't mean that the theory is true. Pay attention. According to Popper, the corroboration given by an experimental test doesn't mean that the theory is true at all, since even a great deal of confirming experimental results are sufficient to assure that a theory is true. Even a great deal of confirming experimental results aren't sufficient to assure that a theory is true. This is because a theory being universal refers to every event of some kind, and therefore we can never exclude that there might be some contradictory event we cannot test. I repeat, this is because a theory being universal refers to every event of some kind, and therefore we can never exclude that there might be some contradictory event we cannot test. In order to make this concept more understandable, Popper mentions a story, Russell's inductivist turkey story. That is this. Once upon a time, there was in a farm a turkey which found that on his first morning he was fed at 9 a.m. Being a good inductivist, this turkey did not jump immediately to conclusions. He waited until he collected a large number of observations of circumstances on Wednesday, on Thursday, on cold days, on warm days, on rainy days, and on sunny days, etc. Each day, this turkey, this inductivist turkey, good turkey, a very good turkey, each day he added another observation, another observation statement to his list. Finally, he was satisfied that he had collected a sufficient number of observation statement to inductively infer that between inverted commas, I am always fed at 9 a.m. However, on the morning of Christmas Eve, he was not fed, but instead he was killed. The moral of this sad story is: inductivism is dangerous. Inductivism is very dangerous, not only for turkeys, but also for scientists and for us. Thus, differently from positivists, do you remember positivism, no, differently from positivism, positivists, also, Popper holds that scientific laws cannot be founded on inductivism, better on positive inductivism, i.e. on the search of experimental confirmations of a theory. Pay attention. Instead, scientific laws, namely scientific theories, have to be founded on the search for their experimental refutations. On the search for their experimental refutation, since just one denial of a theory, i.e. a basic theorem derived from an experiment which doesn't match with one of the theory predictions. Just one denial of a theory is enough to establish that a theory is false. Is false. To sum up, according to Popper, while many validations aren't sufficient to demonstrate the truth of a theory, only one counterexample is sufficient to falsify a theory. While a great deal of validations aren't sufficient to demonstrate the truth of a theory, only one counterexample, refutation is sufficient to falsify a theory. For example, before the exploration of Australia, zoologists believed that all swans are white, because thousands of observations had confirmed that, no, this assert, all swans are white. But it was refuted as soon as a black swan was seen in Australia. In conclusion, Popper claims that the fundamental principle on which science is grounded isn't the positivistic principle of verifiability. But his new principle of falsifiability. In other words, according to Popper, a theory is scientific when it can be falsified by a basic statement deriving from an experimental test. A theory is scientific when it can be falsified by a basic statement derived from an experimental test. Hence, it isn't the principle of verifiability, but the principle of falsifiability is the true criterion of demarcation, of division, of separation between science and non-science, and all the other theories, historical, artistic, religious theories. But there is another remarkable difference between positivists, principle of verifiability, and Popper's principle of falsifiability. According to positivists, verifiability is the criterion of demarcation not only between science and non-science, but also, and first of all, between significance and nonsense, i.e. between knowledge and non-knowledge. Instead, this is the end. Instead, Popper says, falsifiability is only the standard of demarcation between science and non-science, not at all between significance and nonsense. All this means that philosophical, artistic, religious, literary theories aren't scientific, according to Popper, but the same have a cognitive significance. The same have a cognitive significance. So much so that a philosophical theory can become a scientific theory, like Democritus' ancient theory of indivisibles, that has become a scientific theory at the beginning of 20th century. Okay, clear? Some question? It's very late. So, okay, vi saluto e ci vediamo, ci risentiamo settimana prossima. Buon sabato del villaggio, buon weekend, buon intervallo adesso.